subscribe Tag TV YouTube channel and press the notification button.
People have to live in unity.
We are still in transition.
Civil society has been decimated.
Of course, we rely on media.
And I think the government has not done enough.
The international community has failed to respond.
No place in the world is perfect.
Yoga event is held here.
Severe injustice, and they should be stopped.
We should raise our voices.
Condemn this brutal act.
Hello viewers, welcome to Newsweek South Asia, a program that talks about breeding of terrorism and its impact on South Asian nations. Let's begin with the headlines first. India slams Pakistan at SCO meet, says terrorism remains biggest threat. Afghan government and Taliban reach breakthrough to proceed with peace talks. And Global Terrorism Index marks South Asia as most impacted region by terrorism. India, which remains a victim of cross-border terrorism, has time and again raised this issue on international platforms. In a virtual meet of Shanghai Cooperation Organization, India lambasted on Pakistan for using terrorism as an instrument of state policy. The threat posed by Pakistan-sponsored terrorism has created uncertainty in South Asia. We have a report.
Despite facing international pressure to dismantle terror infrastructure and stop financing the terror groups, Pakistan continues to use Islamic terrorists as its proxies against its neighbors, India and Afghanistan. From time and again, New Delhi has exposed Islamabad for its constant support to dreaded terror outfits operating from its soil. In an address at the virtual meet of the Council of Heads of Government of the Shanghai Cooperation Organization, Indian Vice President M. Venkaiah Naidu particularly mentioned about cross-border terrorism and called for combating the menace under a collective approach. Though the Vice President did not name Pakistan in his remarks during the meeting, the reference was amply clear.
Peace is the essential prerequisite for progress, and the most important challenge faced by us in the region is terrorism, particularly cross-border terrorism. Terrorism is truly the enemy of humanity. It is a scourge we need to collectively combat. India condemns terrorism in all its manifestations. We remain concerned about threats emerging from ungoverned spaces and are particularly concerned about states that leverage terrorism as an instrument of state policy.
Pakistan has been using terrorist groups to change the status quo in Jammu and Kashmir, but every time, counter-terrorism actions by Indian Army like Operation All Out have made such plots unsuccessful. Recently, Indian intelligence agencies have alerted security forces to stay alert to the threat of drones capable of carrying loads being used to bomb targets close to the border. Pakistan's ISI, inspired by the success of using cheap drones to carry out small bomb attacks, has been exploring this option for terrorist groups. Indian Army Chief General M.M. Naravane has stated that there are terrorist launch pads across the line of control, and the terrorists are making last-ditch attempts to infiltrate into the valley before snowfall blocks points of entry into India and foils their plans.
There are terror launch pads and terrorists across the line of control. They are making desperate attempts to infiltrate into the Union Territory of JNK and try to create as much trouble as possible and to disrupt the normal democratic processes that we cherish. With the onset of the winters, last-ditch attempts are being made to infiltrate before the passes close and the levels of snow make it almost impossible to cross over. And it is also because of this that they have started moving southwards and are now attempting to infiltrate through the lower reaches, including through tunnels across the international border.
India has urged international community several times to isolate Pakistan for sponsoring terrorism. Not long ago, an European think tank, the European Foundation for South Asian Studies, also accused Pakistan of backing terrorism. It said that the international community's failure to nail Pakistan for 2008 Mumbai terror attacks, even after the 12 years, is highly unacceptable. Pakistan knows clearly that except for a few of its cronies, the world cannot afford to ignore its state sponsoring terrorism for long. While the world is battling the COVID-19 pandemic, it is unfortunate that instead of introspecting, Pakistan is using every opportunity to promote terrorism and creating uncertainty in the region.
Amid a long period of uncertainty over the intra-Afghan dialogue, the Afghan negotiators and the Taliban have finally reached an agreement on the rules and agenda for long-awaited peace talks. The move is being considered as a major breakthrough which will lay out the way for further discussions over more substantive issues, including talks on a ceasefire. A report.
After 19 years of war, the representatives from Afghan government and the Taliban say that they have reached a breakthrough agreement, a preliminary deal to press on with peace talks. A three-page agreement codifying the rules and procedures for negotiating a political roadmap and a comprehensive ceasefire has been agreed upon. It's the first written agreement between the two warring sides in the conflict and is considered significant as it means the warring sides are getting closer to actually starting to negotiate the issues that could end decades of fighting in Afghanistan. The step has been welcomed by the United Nations and Washington. U.S. Special Representative for Afghan Reconciliation Zalmay Khalilzad urged both sides to negotiate a political roadmap and a ceasefire.
I welcome the agreement between the Afghan negotiators and the Taliban. It's a breakthrough because for the first time in 19 years of conflict between the Afghan government and Taliban, a written agreement is being signed. It's a breakthrough because for the first time, both sides have kept aside contentious issues and shown flexibility to reach an agreement.
The peace talks, which began in September, had been delayed because of disagreements over the procedural rules. However, sources say that the negotiating teams recently agreed to include the US Taliban deal, UN endorsements for the Afghan peace process and commitments of the negotiating team as the base for upcoming negotiations. But the deep concerns that accompanied the beginning of negotiations still remain the same. In Afghanistan, the two sides are still at war, with Taliban attacks on government forces continuing unabated.
At a time when the drawdown is taking place and the Americans are leaving Afghanistan, it's a golden opportunity for the Taliban to take on the Afghan government. The contentious issue of recognizing the Afghan government still remains.
Under the US Taliban February deal, foreign forces are to leave Afghanistan by May 2021 in exchange for counter-terrorism guarantees from the Taliban, which are still unfulfilled. The United States has announced the reduction of thousands of US military personnel from Afghanistan by mid-January, leaving just 2,500 troops in the country. However, foreign governments and institutions earlier warned against a premature withdrawal as it could jeopardize peace procedures.
Und es sollte nicht sein, dass überstürzte militärische Rückzugsmanöver aus Afghanistan dieser Friedensprozess gefährdet wird. Deshalb waren ja die letzten Wochen mit den Ankündigungen aus den USA auch so schwierig gewesen, weil wir nicht wussten, welche Auswirkungen hat das auf das Verhalten der Taliban oder eben nicht. Und deshalb wird es für uns außerordentlich wichtig sein, diesen Friedensprozess zu begleiten, auch sicherheitspolitisch. Ich glaube, dass dafür auch die internationale Militärpräsenz in Afghanistan weiter gebraucht wird. Aber natürlich, das Mandat muss auch ein Ende haben. Und unser Ziel ist es, diese Friedensverhandlungen zu einem erfolgreichen Abschluss zu führen und damit das Land auch in die Hände der Afghanen geben zu können.
For Afghans, a ceasefire is a top priority. Thus the question remains, will the Taliban give up their leverage over the Afghan government at a moment when its allies are withdrawing their forces, or is it just a tactic to expel foreign forces and re-establish their Islamic State?
South Asia is among the regions in the world with the highest annual number of fatalities caused by terrorist violence. Ethnic, ideological and political conflicts pose a serious threat to stability and interstate relations. The recently released Global Terrorism Index 2020 says that South Asia was the worst affected region by terrorism in 2019. A report.
On April 21, 2019, a series of coordinated blasts ripped through a peaceful Easter Sunday morning in Sri Lanka. Three churches and three prestigious hotels were attacked, in which over 250 people were killed and hundreds were wounded. It was the biggest terror attack South Asia has seen. The region has faced many such dreaded terror attacks perpetrated by Islamic terrorists. Local grievances and socio-political dynamics have been exploited by terror groups such as Al-Qaeda, the Taliban and the Islamic State. The Global Terrorism Index 2020 says that Afghanistan, Pakistan and India are among the top 10 countries in South Asia which were badly affected by terrorism in 2019. While Afghanistan was reported to be the most impacted of the 163 countries, Pakistan ranked 7th and India ranked 8th on the index that measures the impact of terrorism.
South Asia has been facing the challenge from terrorism for many decades now. There are, of course, a number of reasons for this. Primarily, ethnic separatism, religious extremism, left-wing extremism have been some of the reasons why South Asia is facing the challenge of terror and will continue to do so in the years ahead.
Both India and Afghanistan have been facing the brunt of Pakistan's state-sponsored cross-border terrorism. There exists a well-established nexus between Pakistan's civilian government, military, inter-services intelligence, and the numerous terrorist groups trained and armed in the country. For over several decades, Pakistan has been recruiting, training, arming, equipping, and financing terrorists and helping them infiltrate across the line of control into Kashmir. Pakistan's collusion in the Pulwama terrorist attack in 2019 was accepted recently by country's Science and Technology Minister Fawad Chaudhry on the floor of its National Assembly.
हमने हिंदुस्तान को घुस के मारा है जनाब स्पीकर वहां पे, और पुलवामा में जो कामयाबी है, पुलवामा में जो हमारी कामयाबी है वो इमरान खान की क़यादत में इस कौम की कामयाबी है। उसके हिस्सेदार आप भी सब हैं, उसके हिस्सेदार हम भी सब हैं।
Despite corroborating evidence on Pakistan's role in sponsoring terrorism abroad, the international community tends to turn a blind eye. Most recent being the decision by the Financial Action Task Force to retain Pakistan yet again on the list of jurisdictions under increased monitoring grey list till February 2021. The country has not been put under the high-risk jurisdiction category blacklist for its incessant support towards terror financing and money laundering.
Pakistan has passed many hurdles as far as the Financial Action Task Force restrictions are concerned. From 23, now Pakistan has to comply with four stipulations laid down by the FATF. However, these four stipulations are going to be the most difficult for Pakistan to accede to, primarily because it has to take very stringent, demonstrative action against those individuals who are being on the 1267 and the 1373 UNXC sanctions list, which means individuals such as Hafiz Saeed, they are demonstrating some sort of actions which have been taken in the courts, but their concurrent sentences are running. Masood Azhar, he is nowhere to be seen under any sort of charge sheet in Pakistan, and many others who have been named in the UNSC sanctions list.
India and Afghanistan have raised serious concerns over rising terror threats from Pakistan during diplomatic engagements and other global platforms. Efficacy of regional initiatives to combat terrorism undertaken by groups such as BIMSTEC must be further explored. Nevertheless, there must be ceaseless attempts to compel Pakistan to develop strong counter-terrorism strategies focusing on terrorist groups.
For years, Pakistan has kept the public of Balochistan bereaved of all the primary factors required for their development, as if the absence of fundamental rights, social security and unemployment was not enough. The establishment is now denying them the most basic right to education. However, people in the region have been continuously emboldening their voices against the repressive policies of Islamabad. We have a report.
Scores of students gathered in Quetta, the capital of Balochistan, to seek their right to education. Disgruntled over the injustice done to them, Baloch Students Organization held Student Power Restoration March outside National Press Club in Quetta and demanded the restoration of student unions in educational institutions, an increase in the education budget, and an immediate end to increase in tuition fees. The protesters also call for access to the internet for students from Balochistan, former Fatah, POK, and Gilgit-Baltistan, and the formation of sexual harassment committees to investigate cases of harassment by college and university staff and teachers.
Students ko COVID mein idhar baithne ka koi shauk nahi hai. Wo isliye aa rahe hain kyunki majboor hai. Unki baat nahi suni ja rahi. Unki kahin sunwai nahi ho rahi. Koi platform nahi hai. To ye gussa samjhe, log ki majboori samjhe. Ye hamara asasa hai. Aap inko koi saazish samajh rahe hain. Kabhi inko koi foreign propaganda keh rahe hain. Inki baat sunein, inki dilon mein jo sachai hai use pehchanne ki koshish kare. Agar na kiya to phir ye tehreek aur mazboot hogi aur ye purano ke jo girebaan hain unko pakde.
Pakistani deep state is not just systematically plundering the resource-rich Balochistan of its minerals, but is working at an extensive multi-pronged design to push Baloch towards a political catastrophe. Working on the commands and instructions of the military establishment, the puppet government of Imran Khan is not only exploiting their fundamental rights, but is also denying them education. As per students, there is unnecessary interference of the Pakistani army in universities, and the campuses have been turned into military cantonments. Pakistan government does not want Baloch to read, write and grow into an informed, efficient and employable mass. While the quality of a handful of higher education institutions has degraded considerably owing to the system's apathy, the universities have now ended their scholarships on the reserved seats. Anyone who dares to raise his voice against the Pakistani discrimination and human rights violation in the region is subjected to violence, imprisonment, exile, or even death in some cases. Educated youth means informed youth, and an informed youth will travel any distance to reclaim the rights Pakistan has trampled upon for decades. So this is the reason Pakistan, which claims to be the owner and the well-wisher of the region, has systematically kept people away from education. A handful of those who have managed to get good education have become a thorn to Pakistani eyes, and the authorities have tried almost every devious trick in the book to eliminate them.
And with that, we come to the end of this edition of Newspeak South Asia. We'll be back next week with more news, views and analysis from the subcontinent. Meanwhile, do keep writing to us at nwsa@anin.com. This is Shreyasa Vijay signing off on the behalf of entire production team of Newspeak South Asia. Goodbye and take care.
Subscribe TAG TV YouTube channel and press the notification button.